about Cisco switches and Cisco switching in general. So just let me know once you can see my screen and then we'll move on. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, I can see it.
Nice. Okay. So Cisco switches are just switches in general. So one of the first things that I wanted us to discuss amongst ourselves. So it's not just like somebody sharing. We're sharing knowledge with one another. Is Cisco has different ranges in terms of if you go if you're working in an enterprise, you need switches for your network. You want to buy switches from Cisco. You have to make a decision as to which switch you're going to buy. And Cisco has different models, different classes of switches that they sell. Perhaps like the two most popular ones are the ones they call the Cisco. Let's say the Cisco Catalyst ranges. And then there's another one called the Cisco Nexus. Now, the ones that they call Cisco Catalyst, they run not in all situations, but most of them run the operating system called Cisco iOS. Whereas these Cisco Nexus ranges, they run another operating system called the Nexus OS. So you see many people, so you can just go on Google, and if you do a Google search, you see lots of argument from different people about the differences between Cisco Catalyst and Cisco Nexus, which one is the best, which one is not the best. So in your own opinion, what's like the difference? So has anyone ever heard of Cisco Nexus before, right?
I've heard of it, but haven't used it yet. Kind of scary to think of using it after being on iOS.
Is it? Why is it scary to use? Why is it scary to think of using it?
Well, because like if you look something up and you find the steps for iOS, and then you see the steps for CatOS or NXOS, it just feels like, oh my gosh, I worked so hard to learn what I learned in iOS, and I have to do the exact same thing for a whole new thing.
Yeah. It is true. But here's the other thing. I'm not sure if anyone has actually realized this, but actually, like, I'm not knocking the CCNA. It's a really good certification. I've done the CCNA. But actually, it doesn't fully prepare someone to take on a full networking role. Because actually, if you go to work in the enterprise these days, they expect you to know way much more than what the CCNA teaches. Which some of the things we're talking about today, like why we'll be talking about the Cisco switch hardware, that's not really covered in the CCNA. But if you go to work like in an enterprise, they expect you to know something or a lot about the Cisco switching hardware or the different iOS platforms or the different features that are available. The CCNA covers mainly like the iOS and the operating system, but not necessarily like the hardware itself. And then you'll be surprised that many enterprises are expecting you to know at least a bit of Nexus OS also. But the good thing is that once you can learn one of them, knowledge is transferable to the other. You may just have to learn like different commands, but the knowledge is transferable. One of the best explanations that I found that someone gave regarding the differences between Cisco Catalyst and Cisco Nexus OS is that this one is mainly for user connectivity. Not that that's all it does. It can do more than user connectivity. It can connect servers and stuff like that. But what they're saying is this one is much, much more specialized in terms of like the data center connectivity. And what they mean by data center connectivity is the backbone of your infrastructure. And what do they mean by the backbone of your infrastructure? Your VMware hosts or your Hyper-V hosts. Your Hyper-V hosts, or your storage infrastructure. So things that users would not really interact with directly, but it's serving user. It's kind of like the backbone of your network. So you have massive amount of servers on your VMware, Hyper-V host, massive amount of data on your storage infrastructure, your storage network, and then they have like this ranges of switches. Which so this is the stuff that you learn about if you do like the CCNA data center. It's some of the stuff that you learn about. But today we want to focus on the Cisco Catalyst switch. So first, let's give like a brief introduction to switches and how switches work. So first of all, let's just ask like the normal basic question. What's the difference between a switch and a hub, or a switch and a bridge? What's the difference? Does anyone want to answer that? That's a switch, that's a hub, and that's a bridge. What's the difference between these? Like I said, it's something that we're already aware of before, but we need some refreshers. Oh, I just lost one of my monitors. Okay, so what's the difference between a switch and a hub? Anyone wants to go for that?
I guess switch and hub is just layer 2 and layer 1, right? The hub being layer 1 and not having any intelligence or CAM or MAC address table. Is that
Excellent.
right?
Yeah, excellent. Yeah. So, this is just layer one. No intelligence, things like MAC address table, like you've mentioned. Anything else? What about the bridge? The differences between the Yeah, what about the bridge? What's the difference between the bridge and this? And the switch. Anyone wants to go for that? Mike, you want to answer that? Or Michael? Or Kerry? Oh, Kerry is you're on the road. What about Jamie? You want to answer that? What's the difference between the bridge? So if you're in an interview and I ask you what the difference is between the bridge and the switch, what would your answer be? You may have to unmute yourself to talk. So you need to unmute yourself. So your mic is muted. So you need to unmute it. So yeah, right, Mike. So what Mike said is a switch is just a multi-port bridge. So is that right? Does anyone agree with that? Do you agree with that, Jake? That a switch is just a multi-port bridge. Do you agree with that?
I think I'm trying to really hard to remember, but I think that's the basic concept. But isn't there a software difference as well? I don't know if it's separation of broadcast domains or something like that, maybe. I'm not entirely sure.
So actually, like Mike is partly right. I want to say that like completely right. I know like you read many textbooks or articles that make mention of, yeah, a switch is just a multi-port bridge. No, a switch is more than a multi-port bridge. So the operations of a switch and a bridge are similar, but they are not the same. So one of the things is the one that Jake mentioned. A bridge operates on software, whereas switches operate mainly on hardware. So they have these hardware devices on them called ASICs, and that's what they use to like do a lot of their processes. Whereas a bridge just uses its CPU and does a lot of stuff in software. And then one of the main differences is thinking of a switch and a bridge these days. A switch is full of multiple features. Features that you probably can't get on the bridge. So features that we're referring to features like power over Ethernet, features like QoS. I guess you may be able to get VLANs on bridges, but let's say features like VLANs and lots of features like that you can get on the bridge. Or features like stacking. Or what else? So it has way much more features than a bridge does, if you compare the two together. So when it comes to also like the Cisco world, Cisco has two main categories of the Cisco catalyst switches. So they have two main categories of the Cisco catalyst switches. So the first one is fixed configuration switches, and the second one are modular switches or chassis-based switches. So, you work in an enterprise, you've decided you need to set up a network or replace a switch that's end of life or whatever. One of the first decisions you have to make is, okay, there's lots of models that Cisco sell. Which ones am I going for? Or which what's the particular Cisco switch class that I'm going for? If you decide I'm going for the Cisco Catalyst class of switches, then you have to decide, am I going for the fixed configuration switches or the chassis-based switches? So actually, let's just go to Cisco's website and let's go look for Cisco switches. So if I go, just go on Google and just do a search for Cisco switches, or just go Cisco switches, and you get this page. And you on this page, you get to see a lot of the different products that Cisco sell. So here you can see the campus LAN access switches, and you can see a lot of these are from the Cisco Catalyst range of switches. And you can see, okay, for example, they've got this one, Cisco Catalyst 2960X, Cisco Catalyst 36 and 3650, 3850 and 4500. Now, here's the thing that we mean by fixed configuration switches or modular switches. So, for example, if we open up the Cisco Catalyst 2960X, if we open that up and we actually enlarge this, make it a bit bigger, and if you look at this, it kind of like comes in a box that it doesn't really have that much space for changing the physical hardware. So it comes with what it comes with. Whatever you buy it with, that's what it comes with. So Mike is saying, with new switching architecture, custom ASICs are built into these products like 3Ks, 4Ks, 6500Ks. Right, Mike. We'll give you you'll talk to us about that in a minute. Yeah, so these fixed configuration switches, they come and you can't really like make it. So you buy them and you buy them you, if a port is bad or whatever, or let's say the power supply gets blown off, you may have to just or something is bad inside the switch, you may have to replace the old switch. It comes with a fixed configuration with fixed hardware SKU, and you can't really make that much adjustment. Whereas the other ones that we refer to as chassis-based switches, basically, if you go to Cisco, let's bring up another one. So let's say, let's bring up this one, 4500. And let's go down here to core distribution, and let's bring up the 6800. Okay, actually, there's a better one here. We can view the 3D model. Okay, I think I just need to use Internet Explorer for this one because it doesn't like niche Java. And we'll go Internet Explorer here. Okay, view 3D model. Yep. Doing anything? You're not doing anything. Yeah, okay. Doesn't seem to want to work. Ah, okay, here we go. So hopefully that's gonna open up and we can see what this switch looks like. Yeah, it's looking good. Okay. Yeah, there we go. So, for example, looking at this one, we'll just turn it around a bit. So this is an example of a chassis base or a chassis base and switch, not the fixed configuration one. Because you get this, what you essentially buy at the beginning is you buy the chassis, you buy the box itself or just the case itself. And now, depending on whatever you want to use it for, you can begin to fill it in. For example, you can see this one there. You can see, so basically, you can put, so all this comes empty, and then you fill it in with whatever you want to fill it in with. And then, for example, if we go, let's bring up the note on this one. Okay, here we go. So WSX 4648, 48 port. Yeah, this is not getting stable. Let's just go. Actually, let's go. Yeah, there we go. So look at this, for example. So this in itself. So again, what you buy is you buy the chassis, right? And then you fill it in with whatever you want. So you can buy, for example, this module, and then you can plug it into the chassis and use it. And the same thing, and there's like lots of different modules that you can buy. That you can, for example, this ones, if I go these other ones. So you can see this port and 12 port, 10 gigabit Ethernet SFP plus port. And you buy that. So let's say you want to connect in like maybe some really high-end storage and you need 10 gigabit Ethernet and stuff. You can buy the chassis itself and later you can scale depending on your requirements. So that's one of the benefit of the chassis-based switches is that you can scale based on requirements. Whereas the fixed configuration ones, if we can see a 3D model of a fixed configuration one, like the 3650 or the 2960 switch series, if you can see them, you can't really make modifications to them. So when you buy them, what they come with is what they come with. And let's say later you decide, oh, I need some 10 gigabit Ethernet port. You need to go buy another switch that has a 10 gigabit Ethernet port in most situations because they are fixed configuration switches. And the benefit of fixed configuration switches or the advantages that they have is that they are usually much cheaper. They are cheaper to buy, they are easy to set up. You know, you bring them in, it's already all fixed, all set. Whereas by the chassis base, you have to buy all the different modules that you want and plug them in and do a bunch of work afterwards. But then the thing is, the chassis-based ones are usually more expensive, but at the same time, they are more reliable. So, for example, you could decide, oh, I want two separate line cards so that if one line card fails. So, for those who don't know what, when I say like the line card, I mean the just think of it as the processor. So, like the switch engine or the root processor, the thing that is actually doing the work on the switch, the thing that is actually doing all the work of switching or doing all the work of routing. That particular hardware device, you can decide to buy like two of them so that if one of them goes off, the other one takes over, and all you have to do is send for Cisco, send your replacement, you take out the bad one, you put in the other one. Whereas for this fixed configuration ones, you can't do that. The processor goes bad, you have to get another switch to replace it. But then they are much cheaper. So typically, you see in the enterprise, people use the fixed configuration switches at the access layer. That is where users connect to your network. So they'll use that. But more when you're getting to the distribution layer, if you have a distribution layer, most of many organizations don't have a distribution layer. They have something called a collapsed core. So the core and the distribution layer are collapsed because most organizations are not big enough to warrant a distribution layer. But let's say in your organization you have a distribution layer. So when you start getting to a distribution layer, that's when you start going for things like the modular switches or the chassis-based switches or at the core, because you want that reliability. And then the other advantage is that if you buy these ones from Cisco, their end of lives are usually way much lesser than the chassis-based ones. So for example, if we go look data sheet and literature of this one. Let's look for another one. Let's look for the other chassis-based one. And then if we can see information about maybe their end of life. Okay, that's for Cisco HiRes, not for the hardware itself. Yeah, but one thing to realize is that if you go for like the chassis based one, their end of life are usually way much more longer than the fixed configuration switches. So, does anyone have any question about the things that we've mentioned so far? In terms of if you go out and say, I want to go get a Cisco switch, you have to decide, am I referring to I'm gonna go get a Cisco Nexus switch, or are you referring to I'm gonna go get a Cisco Catalyst switch? Or am I referring to who knows? You want to go get a Cisco Meraki switch if that's what you use, fine. Yeah, but first of all, you make that decision of, hey, am I getting the Cisco Catalyst or am I getting the Cisco Nexus? Like I said, you can just Google Catalyst versus Nexus. You see lots of argument. But for most people, data center where users don't typically access, it's more of like backbone of the infrastructure. You use like the Cisco Nexus, whereas for access layer switches, it's usually like the Cisco Catalyst switches. And then we've mentioned that even for the Catalyst switches, there are two separate types. So there are ones that are fixed configurations, and there are some that are chassis based, which allows you that flexibility, or they are modular based. So you buy these modules and you plug them in depending on what you want. So also the fixed configuration switches, they are different because they are different. They are different. They cater to different demands. So for example, if you get the Cisco, for example, let's go to the access ones. You get the Cisco Catalyst 2960X, for example. If you get this switch, there are different models of this Cisco 2960 that you can get, and that you can see that from the X. That means there's different types that you can get. So you go, okay, Cisco Catalyst 2960, compare models down here, and you go down, and then you see that there are lots of different models of this same switch that we're talking about. So you say, okay, I want the Cisco Catalyst 2960 for an access switch that I'm going to use to connect my users to the network. Yeah, which one of them do you want? And the reason why Cisco has done this is to cater to your organization or the ability of your organization, maybe financially also, mainly. So, and this is where this one begins to lead us into the Cisco HiRes. Because, for example, you have to be careful about this whenever you're thinking about purchasing a Cisco switch. Because, for example, if you buy this model, let's increase this one a bit. Let's zoom. Yeah. So if you buy this particular model, Cisco says the feature sets that you can use on this model is the LAN base. But if you buy this particular model, Cisco says the feature set that you can use is the LAN light. Here is where this one is really important. It's because you cannot upgrade. You can decide, oh, I'll buy this model, but you're like, okay, hold on. I like some of the features that I see in the LAN-based iOS. So therefore, I'm going to upgrade this one from LAN light to LAN base. You cannot do that. So you have to be really careful about this whenever you're selecting your devices. Many organizations will engage maybe a Cisco partner in making these decisions. But you have to be really careful about this, because if you buy this model of the 2960, the only iOS that you can use on it is the one that has the Landlight feature set. And basically, whenever you're thinking about the iOS feature set, think of them this way. So let's bring this one up. So think of them this way. You have the Landlight, which is basically basic layer 2 networking features. That's what you get for Landlight. Then you get the LAN base, which is more advanced layer 2 networking features. Then you get the IP Lite, which has some layer 3 functionality plus advanced layer 2 networking. Plus, then you get the IP base. So you have to be really careful whenever you're selecting this. It's really important that you select the right one. So, for example, even if you say I'm going for the Cisco Catalyst 2960, so it depends. Are you going to go for the one that has are you going to go for the one that has 48 ports or for the one that has 24 ports? So, are you going to go for the one that supports power over Ethernet or the one that doesn't support power over Ethernet? And remember that because these are fixed configuration switches, once you get them, that's it. You can say, oh, I need some power over Ethernet port, therefore, I'll just go buy a module and plug it in. No, you can't. So, with the things that we've mentioned so far, any questions at all? Any questions from anyone with the things that we've mentioned so far?
I'm just curious about the when you're picking your switch and your image type. Can you? I just had to order a switch recently, and I was for some reason under the impression that you could get a 2960X with a base like a the IP base layer 3 image, and they advised instead to go with a 3560X with a with the what I thought was a similar image. Is there something I'm missing as far as why you wouldn't be able to get the same functionality in a 2960 that you can on a 3560? Or is that
So definitely. So for example, so there are some features that are tied to the hardware. There are some features that are tied to the iOS, the software. So features that are tied to the hardware, what do we mean? Here's an example of feature that is tied to the hardware, power over Ethernet. It doesn't matter whether iOS support power over Ethernet or not, your ports, your the switch ports themselves must support power over Ethernet. Now you can get some hardware models that will support power over Ethernet, and you can get some hardware models that won't support power over Ethernet. Another example of a hardware tied feature is stacking. So you can get a hardware that doesn't have it doesn't have a slot that you can plug a stack cable inside into to do switch stacking. So then there are some options. And there are some features that are tied to the iOS. For example, the one you mentioned, where, for example, like the IP base, right? Where you can do some layer 3 functionality. But if you look at this 2960, you see that the highest it goes to is the IP Lite, right? So it doesn't go beyond the IP Lite. And if you look at it, if you go, actually, let's just bring this one. If I go. LAN base versus LAN light, for example, or even bring IP base. Nah, maybe not this one. Yeah, whichever one. So LAN-based image is a superset of the LAN light image. Few of the LAN-based features, mainly PoE, RPS support, features are available in the LAN-based image only after a certain version are not available in the LAN light image. So let's go for one that is way much more clearer. So basically, LAN, for example, if you get, so to answer your question, you get the 2960, the highest feature set that you can get is the IP light. Can you hear me though? Can you hear me? Can you still hear me, guys? Because Jim, because someone said they can't get a clear voice. Can you still hear me clearly? Is my voice too clear? Okay. Let me just reply.
1400. Yes, I'm hearing you.
Okay, let's go to the 3650 range, right? And let's go to compare models. So you get this one. Let's go forward and scroll down. So all models can be purchased with LAN-based. Look at this, IP-based and IP services software. So that means on any 3650, you can use the IP-based image or the IP services image on any 3650. Now, you cannot use the IP-based or IP services software on any 2960. So the highest you can go to is IP Lite. So again, remember, it's LAN Lite, LAN Base, IP Lite, IP Base, IP Services, Advanced IP Services, in terms of iOS feature set. I'm not sure, Jamie, is that clear or is that more confusing?
Yeah, no, that makes sense. I kind of overlooked that the 2960 wouldn't have the exact same iOS options as the 3560.
Exactly. So that's the thing. You give the exact word, the iOS options that you have. So you have to be careful because the iOS options that you have is also tied to the hardware that you buy. So if you buy the 2960, the highest iOS option that you can get to is the IP Lite, which only give you entry level layer 3 functionalities. Whereas if you get the 3650, you can do more advanced layer 3. You can use more advanced layer 3 features because you can use them with IP base, IP services. Let's go for the other one, for this one. Let's go models for the chassis based one. And let's pick one of them. Let's go down. Let's see. Yeah, okay, we'll come back to this one for now. So I hope that's clear. So for example, whenever you're getting this one, for example, you have to decide, because if you get this particular model of the 2960, you can get the S2 uplink SFP plus. SFP plus is the 10 gigabit Ethernet. So you can use that for your uplinks, maybe to your distribution layer or to your core layer. So, good question. Shehab says, so I can't upgrade my iOS. Does anyone want to answer that question? Can you move from LAN Lite to LAN Base? Can you move from LAN Base to IP Lite? Can you? Does anyone want to answer the question? Does anyone want to answer Shehab's question? Mike says no. Okay, Jake, what about you? What do you say?
I say no.
Yeah, well, and Kevin, what do you say? Michael says no. So that's the answer.
I'm sorry, I wasn't listening.
Yeah, no, so what we're asking the question. So Shehab asked the question and say, okay, so I can't upgrade my iOS. So if you buy a 2960, let's say you buy this 2960 switch, and on it, it says you can, let's go. It says the LAN-based feature sets that you have, you can only go to a maximum of LAN-based. So Shehab is asking, can I now upgrade this one and say I'm going from LAN-based to IP light or LAN based to IP based. So let's bring up actually, like there's a particular one where Cisco specifically mentions this. Let's look for the so they have like some sort of like a frequently asked question. Ah, okay, I think this is it. If I'm right, let's expand this a bit, make it bigger. And let's go up. Okay, here we go. What is the difference between the Cisco hardware software feature set? The differences between the three Cisco hardware software feature set are LAN light features as entry layer 2 features and is targeted at mid-market deployment. LAN-based feature set comes with advanced layer 2 features and is typically targeted at enterprise customers. IP light features comes with enterprise layer 3 features and is typically targeted at enterprise customers. But remember that this is entry level layer 3, so you can still get IP based that will give you way much more. And it tells you here, how can I tell the difference between IP light and this one? So this is how you can tell from the naming and the command you can use to tell what you're running. So there's a place here where they mentioned that. Can I not just go from? Aha! Look at this. Do I need a software license for the Cisco Catalyst 2960X series switches? No. Cisco Catalyst 2960X series switches used in universal image, but no license is required. The feature set is bound to the hardware model type and cannot be changed. For convenience, a single software image is used for all Cisco Catalyst switches, regardless of whether they are this one. So in other words, all these ones that we're talking about, all the 2960 series, they are running the exact same image called the universal image. But the feature sets that you can use, whether it's IP light, it's bound to the hardware itself. So you said the feature set is bound to the hardware model type and cannot be changed. So they are all running the same image, but the feature that you can use, whether you can go up to the IP light feature, it's bound to the hardware itself. So if you get, going back to the other one, if you get one that can only go up, that the hardware only supports to a maximum of LAN-based image, that's as far as you can go. You can upgrade this one and say, I'm going to IP light. That's as far as the hardware will allow you to go. So is that clear, Shehab, or any other question regarding that? Is that clear? Or does anyone else have any question regarding that? Ah, okay. Okay, so that's the thing to realize about whenever we're talking about like the Cisco hardware is, easy thing is, read the documentation on Cisco's website about the switches themselves. Preferably, people will work with a Cisco partner, but if you're like a much more smaller organization and they're expecting you to make this decision, even if you're going to make the decision, still call Cisco. You know, they'll pick your calls. Call Cisco sales, have a chat with them about, this is what we're looking to do, this is what I'm looking to buy. From what I've read on your website, I think this one would be good. What's your advice? Just talk to them. So again, just have a look through whichever model that you'll be buying. Look at what it supports hardware wise and look at what it supports in terms of the feature sets that you can go up to. So here's the thing is that, okay, like this is like the 2960. If you go up a little bit and you go to the 3650, so you get like much more features than that. But then some other things that you can get start to get is things like stacking. So for example, some of these switches on the 2950, they do support stacking. So flex stacking plus flex stack plus or plus stacking. So optional. So these ones don't support. These ones are optional. So some of them support stacking. And does anyone know what stacking is? Or does anyone want to explain to us what stacking is? What switch stacking is? Jake, because you've been answering a lot.
I can take a stab at it, and everybody can laugh at how wrong I'll be.
No, it's all right. We're learning from one
I
another,
think
so
switch stacking is stacking switches, so you have one switch that is the administrative switch that is the head of the stack, and it is connected through redundant connections to the switch below it, and then that one will connect to the switch below it, and eventually at the bottom of the stack, you will connect back up to the top switch, and you can administer them all from the administrative switch or the head switch, I guess. And I think you can even do stuff like
Excellent, huh?
show the contents of flash on every switch just from that head switch, can't you?
Excellent, yeah, you're right. So that's really like that's exactly what it is. So some of these models, whether for 2960 or 3650, some of them do support stacking, and it's exactly what Jake has mentioned. What stacking just provides you is easy management. So for example, if I go, let's go to Google again and let's look for one of our switches. So let's go for Cisco 2960. And let's bring up an image for Cisco 2960. Let's go paint. Where are you? Paint. Paint. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. My internet is a bit upset. So, okay, here we go. Images. Let's just get one of these. Don't need this packing cable, yeah. So, something like this. So, let's bring this one. Actually, let's just copy this one. So, copy image and let's go to paint. So, what that means is you have your environment. Let's say you have like all these different closets in your environment where you have a huge office, you have this area here where there's like about 40 people in this area. You have another area on the second floor where there's about 40 people there. Now you have to provide access to them to the network, and you have your access switches. Let's say you've gone for the Cisco 2960, the type that supports stacking. So you have different options. So in your access room or your whatever you call it, your cabinet, whatever you have on the first floor here, you could decide to buy different Cisco 2960 switches and just have them one here, another one here, and have about four of them, like in this case, and do the same over here and have about four of them in this case. And then you're like, oh, there's something wrong with this switch. So what that means is that as an administrator, you have to know the names and IP addresses, the management IP addresses of all these switches, so that in case you need to do something for me, you log into this one, you make any change, you log into this one, if you want to make any change, you make any change. But what stacking allows us to do is, as you can see from this image, is you have these cables at the back, and it's part of the things that we wanted to talk about today. So you have these cables at the back that connects the switches to one another, and the reason for that is this. So if you get a Cisco switch, right, on a Cisco switch you have your ports. Each port that we're looking at on the Cisco switch has its own queue. So this port has its own queues, this port has its own queues, this port has its own queues. How do these ports connect together at the back? There's something called the switch fabric at the back. So actually, let's go bring up let's bring up this one. Let's go for Cisco switch components, and let's bring up a good diagram on this. Images. One better, a clear one. Okay, for example, you see this one. We're talking about, oh, at the back here, they said there's something called a switch fabric. And actually, like, I need a more clearer picture, maybe. I want that much more clearer. So these ones are referring to the other, but they're not mentioning the fabric. So switch component. Let me put fabric or Cisco switch fabric. Maybe that's gonna come up. Still coming up with. I need one that is not, because they're showing the ones that are line cut. I guess because it's easy to open these ones. So, or it's easy to see inside them. Yeah, okay, yeah. I guess we'll just go for the modular one because it's the one that's mainly shown here. So at the back here, you can see something called the switch fab. Oh, actually, this one isn't bad also. So actually, this one, it's not as fancy as the others, but it's showing, so you have slot one, slot two, slot three, slot four. And at the back here, you have something called the switch fabric, which connects all your ports together at the back end. And it has like I number of like, but actually, if you go to look at the, sorry, for my, watching my crime shows. So if you go to look at the Cisco 2960, for example, I think they should, part of the information that they give should contain information of what the fabric is. Is this the 2960 fabric? No, not found. Okay, let's go for data sheets and literature. Data sheets, technical specifications. Let's open this technical specification. Okay. I was looking for information about the backend fabric. Ah, okay. Yeah, there's no information here about the backend fabric. But here's the thing is that if you look at this, it said, okay, Flex Stack Plus for stacking of up to 8 switches with 80 gigabit per second of stack throughput. So what I was trying to point out is that in your switch, you have the switching fabric, which is really, really high bandwidth, which connect like all these ports together. So what these cables are doing, and you can see they're really, really high bandwidth. I mean, think of it. These cables are connecting them with 80 gigabits per second of stack throughput in the backend. What that's basically doing is extending the switch fabric in the backend. So that's what these cables are doing, is extending the switch fabric in the back end so that these switches operate basically as one. So that if you want to manage any of this, any ports in this closet, all you need to know is one IP address, one management IP address, or one switch name, DNS name. And you can log into this and manage any port on any of these switches. So that's like the advantage that provides. And not all of the models support this, but there are a lot of 2960 models that support this. There are a lot of 3650 models that support this. So then you can basically just treat them as one and just have this cable extend the switch fabric between one another at the back so that they basically operate similarly to one. So that's like for that one. So another one that you should be careful of is the power over Ethernet, because whatever you select will determine what you can use. So you can see they do provide different wattage in terms of the power that they allow you to use. So you have to be careful of whichever one you select. If you're going to be using a lot of VoIP phones, you have to select the right ones. And this one's just for SFP. What that's talking about is you have four fiber over Ethernet ports, which is 1 gigabit per second, which is SFP. SFP plus is 10 gigabits per second. So just be aware of that. Okay, so having talked about that, I just lost my other, monitor. Okay, there we go. So any questions again regarding the things that we've discussed so far? Any questions, anything that's not clear, anything that's confusing regarding what we've mentioned so far? So again, we just been talking about the hardware and then just basic introduction, because things like this, they may not like really emphasize it on CCNA, which is one of the reasons why, again, it's like the CCNA does provide like good benefits. But okay, yeah. So nice. Thanks very much for that. So Mike just sent us a link about Here's a very good link to Switch Fabric. Nice one. Ah, excellent. Excellent, Mike. So it's in the chat window if you need this one. So excellent one. So let's expand this. Because the Switch Fabric is the core of the Cisco CRS four slot line card chassis. The Switch Fabric is implemented through Switch Fabric cards installed in the chassis. They used as a self switch, buffered, three stage. Yeah, so just if you want much more information, I think I will definitely be going through this one just to learn much more. So yeah, thanks very much for that, Mike. Thanks very much. Okay, so let's move a step further to discuss some of like the hardware features, software features. Let's move a step further. Let's talk about the operations of a switch. So like we mentioned before, you get your typical 2960. It has ports. Now, all these ports that we're seeing, again, like we mentioned, they have queues on them. So we won't go into details now, but one thing to know is that all these ports, every single port on the switch has an ingress queue and an egress queue. So right here, let's say there's a little queue here where frames can be stored. And this is saying, hey, these are frames that are going out and these are frames that are coming in. So they have a queue on them. And by queue, we're talking about memory. So that's an interesting thing. So that means we're talking about buffer. So that means all the ports that you're looking at, they do have memories. So every port has a queue assigned to it. Actually, they have queues, not just one queue. They have queues that they use. And they have ingress queues and they have egress queues. And of course, on the switch, we have the ASIC that we mentioned about, which is actually the thing that does the processing. So this is the thing that's actually doing the work. This is the thing that's determining, oh, a frame has come into this port. So let's take this one down. So a frame comes into this port, or sorry, it comes to the ingress queue of this port. It's like I want to go somewhere. The ASIC is the one that makes a decision as to where am I going to send this frame? How am I going to send this frame? In what way will I send this frame? Do I have to process this frame first before processing this other frame? The thing that makes that decision is the ASIC on the switch. And it's hardware, which is why switches are way much more faster than routers. So one of the main differences is that switches are way much more faster because they do things in hardware. So in other words, the CPU on this switch is not the one that's making decision as to am I going to be, where will I send this? How will I send it? It's not the CPU that's making this decision. It's this hardware device here. Whereas on a typical router, it's the CPU that has to make that decision. Which leads us again to the other question that many people ask. Layer 3 switch or a router? Many people ask the question that, okay, are you telling me that I can have layer 3 switch, a switch that can do routing functions? So hold on, why do I need to use a router? Does anyone want to answer that? If you can have a switch, because we've mentioned about the fixed configuration switch and the chassis-based switches in terms of hardware. And then we've talked about the different feature sets that are available, the LAN base, the LAN light, the IP light, IP base, IP services, advanced IP services. And then there's something called the universal image that we also saw. And we saw that the 2960 switch range, actually they all run the same universal image. But the thing is the feature sets are tied to the hardware. So that once you get the hardware, you may be running the same image as the other guy, but you cannot use the same features as the other guy. So you may both have 2960s, but if you have different models of 2960s, that allows you to go to use more feature sets. You may have the same hardware, but you cannot you can't use the same functionalities. So then there are different types of switches in terms of. There's a switch that does only layer 2 functionality. So this one is more software based, depending on the software feature sets that or the allowance that you have in terms of like software feature set. Or it can do something called multi-layer switching. In other words, it can do switching and also some routing capabilities. So if we can have a switch that uses hardware for making its decisions about where will I forward this frame, it uses hardware. It doesn't need to be doing everything in software and using the memory and the CPU. This hardware is basically processing all these as they're coming in. It's basically processing them really, really fast. Why do I need a router then? Why don't we just use layer 3 switches and forget about routers? Anyone wants to answer that question? Jake, again, because you've been answering, so I go to you again.
There, I guess
Why?
the only thing I could think of is that there's some software differences between the router and the switch as far as broadcast domains and collision domains, and then things like VLAN management with sub interfaces. And physically, you have a lot more options with a router. You could do a whole like a core with an entire I guess row of fiber uplinks to your access or distribution switches, whereas if you get even a 3560X running full L3 implementation, you're still going to have a lot of hardware limitations that you wouldn't have with a router.
So you're right to a very, very large extent. So that's a very, very good answer. So if someone were to ask me though and say, why not just go for layer 3 switches? The answer I will give is this. Despite the fact that this switch does a lot of things in hardware, right? And it's really, really fast. So this hardware that is a blessing to it is also the hardware that is the limitation. Because there till today, there are still certain functions that this ASICs cannot do. One of such functions is NAT. So NAT is popular, right? So you want to go out to the internet, you have to have address translation. Till today, there's still no ASICs that can do NAT. It has to be done in software. So why this provides an advantage in terms of it's very fast because it's doing a lot of its functions in hardware. Because of that hardware, it also has limitations because it's easy to design software, to design features around software than to engineer hardware to perform features. So it's easy to just design softwares and then modify the software as you go. Than for you to now engineer a hardware device that will do something, and or engineer a hardware device that will do multiple things. So hardware engineering is way much more complex than software engineering. So it's one of the reasons why. So it uses ASICs as one of its for making its decisions, but at the same time, it's also its limitation. So that's the answer that I will give. So you have these ASICs that's the one making the decisions for this switch. So, a frame comes in on this switch. The frame is going to a destination somewhere. This switch has it has a switch is a really simple device. It has a set of processes that it goes through. And the process is really, really easy. So, number one function that a switch does is it learns. And what does it learn? It learns MAC addresses. In other words, a frame comes into this, the ingress queue on this switch port. So there's a device here that wants to talk out. There's a frame, so it puts a frame in this queue. So again, all this happens at wire speed. So a frame is put into this ingress queue and says, "Hey, I'm going. I want to go to a destination." ASICs picks it up, and the first thing that happens is it learns the MAC address of where this of the source MAC address of this frame. That's the very first thing it does is it learns the MAC address. And the reason for that is simple, is because a switch, or let me rephrase that, a layer 2 switch makes forwarding decisions based on MAC addresses. It's really simple. So how am I going to forward? So that's why you can, you know, I'm not saying it's easy to do the hardware engineering, but what this thing is actually doing, it is a really simple process. It's, hey, the decision I'm making, it's simple. I'm making a decision of how I'm going to forward you based on your MAC address. That's all the layer 2 switch does. I'm making a decision of where I'm going to forward you based on your layer 2, based on your MAC address. And the very first thing when you receive this frame is I have to learn the MAC address of where you came from. And the reason for that is it's going to help me in the future when somebody wants to communicate with you, because I know who lives on this port. So let's say the machine that connected to this port has a MAC address of AAA. So, and it wants to talk to a machine connected here that has a MAC address of BBB. So this frame comes in to this ingress queue on this port. Frame comes in as source AAA. Actually, let's draw a bigger frame. Let's draw a bigger frame. Of course, it has all this different stuff of, here's my source MAC. Let's go up a bit. So let's say source MAC is AAA. Destination MAC, let's say the MAC. Destination MAC is BBB, and then at the end of this, you'll probably get something like the checksum. So it calculates the checksum, which is used to check if there are errors on this or not. So it calculates the checksum. So the frame comes in as this source MAC, as this destination MAC. The first thing when this frame comes into this ingress queue is the switch we go, I need to learn the source MAC address. Because you came out of this port, I know that any source MAC address lives behind this port. So it has a table that it uses for this. So we may not be able to get to this today. So there are different types of tables. So on a layer 2 switch, there are different types of tables. On a layer 2 switch, there's something called the CAM table, or popularly known as the MAC address table. So we may not be able to get to the one for the layer 3 switch today, but just be aware that a layer 3 switch also has some tables. It also has the CAM table, but it has more than the CAM table. It has another table called the TCAM table. So CAM table is content addressable memory, and TCAM is ternary content addressable memory. And we'll talk about this when we get there, because what this one does is, this is why layer 3 switches are faster than routing, because the routing functionalities that the layer 3 switch can perform, it performs them in this hardware. And it uses this table called the TCAM to do this. So like, for example, your routing tables is going to compile them, compile all those routing tables, and it's going to store them in hardware, so that as packets, not frames this time, as packets are coming in at wire speed, it can decide that is where it's going to. It doesn't need the CPU to make the decision. It's making this decision in hardware, not using CPU. So, but we'll talk about TCAM when we get there. So we have the CAM table, we have the MAC, which is also like the MAC address table. And the MAC address table, you see something like this. You see something like, here's the MAC address. You see, here's the VLAN, which again, it's a future topic. Here's the VLAN. See, here's the port. So it's going to go, oh, I've just received this frame. I'm going to say, so by default, let's say it's on VLAN 1. So it's going to say AAA is the MAC address. The VLAN is 1. The port is 1. It's going to save that in its CAM table. But of course, when this one comes in, this guy probably doesn't know where this guy lives to begin with. So again, that's like something that we'll discuss when we get there. So it's going to send an app query. This one is going to reply. So once this one replies, it's going to go, oh, okay, I'm going to lend the MAC address of this one also. So it's going to go in its table and say, hey, there's BBB. Its VLAN is one. Its port is number 7. It's going to say, leaves on port 7. So it's going to be learning all this stuff. So as it's receiving frames, the first thing it's doing is I have to learn this frame. It's going to learn the MAC addresses where they came from. And that's what it's going to be using for its forwarding. And after it learns them, so that's the very first thing it does. So the next thing that it does is it looks at the destination. So now I've learned it, I have to make a decision of where I'm going to forward this. So it looks at the destination MAC and checks if it exists in the CAM table. So actually I missed a step here because it's going to learn it the first time. But actually what it's going to do is it's going to check if it exists. So if it exists on the CAM table, it's not what the main thing that it's going to do is it's just going to update the timestamp. So actually I need to add that here. So I need to add MAC address, VLAN port and timestamp. So this one is important for this reason. So the reason why this one is important, let's go say this one is 01 01 is when I learned this, and I learned this one at 01 02. So the reason why this one is important, we'll get there. So again, it's going to learn the MAC address, going to look at destination MAC and check if it exists on the CAM table. If it exists, it's going to BBB. It's going to be like, yeah, I know exactly where to send you. You live on port 7. Therefore, at wire speed, I'm going to forward this frame out of this. So, but then the other question now comes in. What if it now looks in its table and I can't find this MAC address in my table. So this MAC address is not on the table. So this is the table. So my whole existence, again, a switch is very simple. My whole existence is I'm making decisions of how to forward this frame based on one table. That's my whole existence. There's a bit much more complications, but we'll get into that one later, because you can have, even at layer 2, you can have security ACLs and you can have QoS ACLs. But we get into that one later. Yeah, so just be aware again that they exist. So let's just talk about this one for now. So we'll talk about, even at layer 2, you can have security ACLs and QoS ACLs, and we'll talk about those ones when we get there. So it goes, my whole existence is I have this table that I'm using to make the decisions of how I forward all these things that are thrown at me. Now this frame has come in, I have no idea where to send it because it's not on my table that I used to make my decision. What it's going to do is, if it doesn't exist, it will flood it to every port, and I'll put in blanket, on that VLAN, to every port on that VLAN except the port that it came from. So it's going to go, okay, if I can find you, I know where to forward you. If I can't find you, what I'm going to do is every port that is also on VLAN 1, I will send you out of all those ports apart from the ports that you came out from. And the hope is that it will get to the destination somehow. The destination will reply. And as the destination reply is coming in, I can learn exactly where you are. So the next time, my forwarding will be quicker because now I know exactly which port you're leaving out, which port you are. So I can forward you really, really quickly next time. So the reason why the timestamp is important is, let's say there's this device AAA used to be on this port. And as happens in the enterprise, the user moves to seat number 6 instead of seat 1. So now you take the user's device and plug it into seat number 6. So it's going to go, okay, I have this in my table. But all of a sudden, a frame appears. And this frame says my source is AAA and I'm on port 6, it's going to go, okay, hold on, I have AA in my table already. But it's going to see this timestamp is definitely older than the current timestamp. So that means AA must have moved. Therefore, I will delete this from my MAC address table completely. And what I will do is I will create a new entry with this new timestamp for this. So basically, when there's like a conflict, the timestamp wins. So the latest timestamp wins in the MAC address table. And just if just we won't go into like big details or anything, but let's go. So it's really easy to see like the I think I'm thinking I need to make this options preferences. I need to make the client way much more font. Okay, yeah. Let's make this bigger. 16. Apply. Cluster. Yeah, okay, that's better. Yeah, and it's actually so if I go show MAC address table, that shows me the camp table. So you can see it got so it's not showing the timestamp here, but it does keep no problem share share. So it does keep the timestamp also. And if you want to set a static so if you sometimes you may decide you want to set a static MAC address, you can go MAC address table static, and you can set what your MAC address is. And you can set what the VLAN is, and then the interface, and then it's going to store this in the table. So one other thing to note is that by default, if a frame is not received, it's going to clear out the entry in the MAC address table every 5 minutes. So that's every 300 seconds, it's going to clear it out. But that's not a problem because if any frame is received, it will learn it again. But if no frame is received, it's going to clear it out. Now, if you want to adjust the aging, you can adjust the aging by using this same address. But I'm not sure if this will work in. Yeah, it's not going to work in packet tracer, sorry. But you can adjust the aging. So it's MAC address table aging, and then you set the aging time. So any questions regarding what we've talked about today, or any contributions that anyone wants to make, anything that you want to share with us regarding the things that we've discussed, feel free to do it now before we call it a day. So Jake, any contributions that you want to add, just so we can learn from one another and stuff?
No, sir, not at the moment.
Yeah. Over Kerry, Massin, Michael and Mike, any contributions, anything, any questions, contributions, thoughts, opinions that you want to add? We'll call it a day for today. Ah, okay. Yeah, nice one then. Okay, oh, nice one. Thanks very much for that, Mike. So I really like that. Thank you. Keep that coming, Mike. I really, really like all this. So what I'll do is all these links that Mike is posting, I'll post them on the page. Because again, remember, though, even though we're studying for CCNA and stuff, don't let us limit ourselves to CCNA, because in the real world, there's way much more. Like CCNA, there's way much more. So learn as wildly as possible if that's your method. If your method is to stick to something, use your method. So yeah, nice one. So even though this may not be on CCNA, learn, I mean, nice one. Excellent information about stacking, understanding switch stacks. And this excellent information. So we can exactly nice one. Thanks very much for that, Mike. So I'll put all this on the community page and all that. And then we'll meet next week again and we'll carry on with our discussion on switches. So because the thing that I want I will put yeah. Yes, Mike. Nice one. Yeah. So because we want to learn from you, because I know there's a lot of contribution you would like to make. So we want to learn from one another. So the goal is we become really good at switching. We understand switching. So it doesn't matter whether it's CCNA level, CTMP level, or whatever. But the thing is, we understand switching. Yeah. So that's the goal of like this series that we're doing. So we'll continue again next week on switching. So and some of the Hangouts will be doing labs. So if you have GNS3 packet tracer, just get them ready. Because some of them will just sit down, we won't discuss anything, we'll just have labs to do. So, okay. So if there's no questions, contributions, ideas, or opinions, I'll see you next week then. Have a wonderful evening.
Thanks, you too.
Yeah, no problem. See you. Bye, guys.